Shalom, we're here to talk about Rabbi Nachman of Breslov, one of the key figures in the history of Hasidism and the history of Jewish mysticism. Hasidism has been a part of the Jewish religious landscape now for a quarter of a millennium period, 250 years. It has remained over all these years, I must say, a controversial movement, even though it is now deeply established and long established as a part of Jewish life. It can be seen both from within the movement and from the outside. I speak as an outsider to Hasidism, but I am aware of those two different perspectives. Hasidism is at the same time two seemingly very different things. It's a movement of religious revival and spiritual awakening. It finds the presence of God everywhere. It talks about how everything in life can be a way of serving God. It makes radical theological claims about the overwhelming presence of God in all of life and creating what you would call a devotion-centered Judaism. On the other hand, it's also a movement that's extremely conservative, that works very hard against any changes in traditional Jewish life of any sort, preserving styles of life, styles of family, educational modes, even forms of dress, as we know, that exist in the 18th century, as though they are all sanctified and can't possibly be changed. From the point of view of the Hasid inside the movement, those two aspects, the spiritual revival and the extreme traditionalism, absolutely fit together and are one and inseparable from one another. When seen from the outside, they're seen as quite separate. Hasidism is a radically innovative movement, primarily belonging, by the way, historically, to the first 50 years of the movement, and then the ultra-conservative move of Hasidism, coming in the second period, you might say, after 1800, generally speaking, from outside the movement, those who love Hasidism emphasize the former, the spiritual renewal, the revival, the presence of God. Those who dislike Hasidism emphasize the extreme, ultra-conservative refusal to change, opposition to modernity. Now, when seen from within the movement, Breslov is a tiny footnote in the history of Hasidism. If you ask any Hasid, at least until prior to the last 20 years, shall we say, if you ask any Hasid anywhere, one of the major Hasidic groups, one of the important figures in the history of Hasidism, the Baal Shem Tov, the Maggid, Rabbi Elimelech, Rabbi Yitzchak, Rabbi Ditcher, almost nobody would list Rabbi Nachman of Breslov. The Breslovers were a tiny group, numerically. They were the most impoverished of all the Hasidic groups. They were marginalized and seen as kind of an aberration or almost outsiders to the consensus of what Hasidic life was about. They were much more dour and serious than some of the other Hasidic groups. They took things to an extreme from the point of view of some of the other Hasidic communities. They were, well, first of all, the most salient feature of Breslov Hasidism, of course. By the way, the name of the town is Breslov. Breslov with a tzadeh in Hebrew or Yiddish. It is not Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia, which the Jews call Pressburg, and it is not Breslau, now called Wrocław in Poland, which was once part of Germany. It is Breslov, a small town of the Ukraine. The Hasidim insist on pronouncing it Breslov rather than Breslov, because Reb Nachman once said, if you called it Breslov and switched the letters around, you would get the phrase Lev Basar, the heart of flesh. Hence they call themselves Breslover rather than Breslover Hasidim. Seen from within the movement, Breslov was a tiny group. They were mocked by others. The most salient feature of the Breslov movement, of course, was that their Rebbe had died. Reb Nachman died in 1810 and left no son, heir, or disciple who claimed the mantle of Rebbe after him. To be a Breslov Hasid means to be a personal disciple of Rabbi Nachman. To this day, he is your Rebbe, you are his disciple. If you walk into any Breslov shul or minyan, you'll see a little modest sign somewhere on the wall that says, by prayers recited in this room, I bind my soul to the souls of all the tzaddikim, and especially to that of Nachman ben Feiget. That's Rabbi Nachman of Breslov. They were called by the other Hasidim, therefore, the Toitz Chassidim, the dead Hasidim. Their Rebbe was dead. And the Breslovers had a famous quip which they used as a response to that. Better a dead Rebbe who's alive than the other way around. And indeed, they were right, of course, because being the so-called dead Hasidim kept the Breslov movement from declining the way other Hasidic movements did. When the grandson or the great-grandson of a charismatic was no longer a charismatic, but merely an imitator, by the end of the 19th or turn of the 20th century, in some cases earlier, in some cases later, Breslov was able to hold on to its absolute devotion to its one figure, who indeed was the uncompromised great Reb Nachman, their only Rebbe. But the others saw it differently. The Savraner Rebbe, Reb Moshe Tzvi of Savran, persecuted the rest of his Rebbe mercilessly in the 1830s and 1840s. And they once asked him, why do you bother so much about them? When you sit down at your table on Friday night, you have 5,000 Hasidim around you. When Reb Nachman, that's Reb Nachman's disciple, sits down in Breslov, he has 80 people. Why don't you leave him alone? And the Savraner said to him, responded, I'll say it in Yiddish, I'll translate it. By mir sitzen 5,000 Chassidim. I have 5,000 Chassidim, by er sitzen 80 Rebbeim. But he has 80 Rebbes. In other words, he understood that in Breslov the stakes were much higher. You weren't trying just to have disciples. You were trying to turn everybody into a tzaddik, everybody into a spiritual master. That's the demand Nachman made of his disciples. But they were misunderstood. If you open the great bibliography of Hasidism and later Judaism, Shema Dor HaChadash by Aaron Baldwin, written in the 1860s, and turn to Nachman of Breslov, he'll warn you, stay away from his books. He can't quite say there was anything wrong with Nachman, but he says, his students misunderstood him, and therefore there are dangerous and misleading things in these books, so it's best to avoid them. I'll tell you a personal story. My own teacher, Rabbi Joshua Heschel. I once asked Heschel why he almost never quotes Nachman in his writings. He quotes many Hasidic sources, but Nachman of Breslov is hardly ever among them. And he told me the following story. He said, when I was 11 and a half years old, Heschel was a child prodigy back in Warsaw. When I was 11 and a half years old, he said, I began having doubts about my faith. And somebody told me to read Likutei Moran, to study Rabbi Nachman's teachings. I went to my uncle, the Novominsky Rebbe. This is why I tell you the story. I went to my uncle, the Novominsky Rebbe, who had a famous large Hasidic library in Warsaw. And I asked him for Likutei Moran. He said, I wouldn't have that book in my house. Which is very interesting. Another sort of a Lithuanian school of Hasidic Rebbe is saying that book is not kosher. That book is not part of the canon of Hasidism. And then Heschel went to somebody else who gave him the book. He said, by the way, that he studied nothing but Reb Nachman for half a year. And he became so depressed that he was frightened and put it away and never went back to it, which is why he doesn't quote Nachman. So within the Hasidic movement, they started to say he's not considered important. But for those outside Hasidism, for those who began after the turn of the 20th century, after the great battle between Hasidism and the forces of modernity was pretty much considered over, and Hasidism was vanquished, and people outside Hasidism began to rediscover the beauty and values of the Hasidic movement, for those people, Nachman is right at the center, one of the most important figures. I refer to the two most important of these people are Martin Buber, who wrote in German for Jews and others in the West, and Hillel Zeitlin, who wrote in Hebrew and Yiddish for people in Eastern Europe. Both of them put Rabbi Nachman right at the center of their writing as one of the most important and fascinating figures the movement created. It was precisely the extreme quality, the religious seriousness. This was not just song and dance Hasidism. This was not trivial Hasidism, as the movement had become by the 20th century. It was obviously spiritually transformative, demanding, important. But it was also because, of course, of the great literary quality you find in the best of sources. We'll come back to Rabbi Nachman's stories in a little while, but the fact that he was such a lyrical, almost poetic figure, a man whose fantasy and imagination ran free in just incredibly creative ways, certainly fascinated and attracted these modern writers. Above all, of course, was the figure of Rabbi Nachman himself. A young man, he died at age 38, and therefore was a relatively young master with a younger group of disciples around him. His disciples are mostly in his 20s for the 10 years, less than 10 years, that he had a cadre of disciples. the tremendous demands on him, the way he had people transform their lives. But I want to read you a little bit. I'm going to read you several passages from Nachman's own writings. They're quoted in my book, Tormented Master, but you can, these are all primary sources. Nachman's image of what a Rebbe is, I find it in two places. One, his tale called The Master of Prayer, Baal Tfilah. The Master of Prayer is his ideal form, his fantasy form of what a Hasidic Rebbe should be. Once there was a Master of Prayer, who spent all his time in prayer, song, and praise to God. He lived in a place outside the Tamar village, but would frequently go into the nearby town. There he would go up to someone, generally choosing a poor person or one of low status, and would enter into conversation with him about the ultimate meaning of life in the world. There is no meaning in the world, he would say, except to serve God while you are alive. Therefore you should spend all your years in prayer to him and in songs and praises. He spoke at length about these matters, hoping to awaken something in the other, until finally the words would find their way to the other man's heart, and he would decide to join him. As soon as the person who agreed, the Master of Prayer would take him to his place outside the town. In that place he had chosen, they ran a stream, and beside the stream were fruit trees, and they would eat of the fruit. As for clothing, that didn't concern them at all. You wore whatever you wanted. This was the regular way of the Master of Prayer. He would begin to chant, convince people that you only serve God and sing to him all their days. And when they were willing to do so, he would bring them out to his chosen place. There they spent all their time in hymns and praises, confessions and fasts, penitence and self-mortification. The Master of Prayer gave them some of his books, which were filled with hymns and confessions, and they were poor over them. That's Nachman's ideal. That's what he would like. He would love to live off in the woods someplace with a band of disciples who would spend all their time pouring out their hearts to God in loving devotion, in study, and in prayer. Now that Nachman's comment on Abraham our father, Abraham Avinu, listen to how he understands Abraham. It's a figure very much parallel to this Master of Prayer. Abraham our father would also bring young people close to God. These are the converts he made, the nefesh. This was his way. When he came into a town, he would run through the street screaming, "Oh, Lord, get out, get out!" People went after him as they went after a madman. Then he would get into arguments with people, lengthy arguments, to show them their errors. Abraham knew all the rational arguments upon which paganism was based. In this way, he was able to show them how wrong they were and to reveal to them the true and holy faith. A few of the young people were drawn to him. He didn't bother with the elders, who were too rooted in their early ways, and thus harder to change, but young people did follow him. Thus he went from town to town and lived after him. The parents and wives of these young men argued with him, saying they had turned to wicked ways and had renounced their faith. Some of the young men backed away when they heard their family's complaints, while a few stayed with Abraham and remained close to him. Of course, Abraham Avinu was not one of Ratzlav, or is the Hasidic master who was attracting young people away from their parents, and the fathers and often fathers-in-law who are supporting them are furious when they go follow a Hasidic master. So he sees Abraham Avinu, Abraham our father, as the first such Hasidic master, seducing young people away from conventional life, having them go off to the woods, go up with this seeming crazy man, and follow him. That's the kind of group, the kind of sect, if you will, that Nachman dreamed of creating. When people came to him, when they became his disciples in the early years, he made a very difficult demand on them. Confess all your sins to me, everything since childhood, all the way back. And they had to pour out their hearts. There's precedent for that in Judaism. We find it odd because we think of confession as so much more associated with Catholicism than Judaism, but there is precedent for after a few years, apparently, that was too burdensome, too difficult, either for too difficult the demand for the disciple or too burdensome on the master, we're not sure which, so he ended it. And when he ended it, he created a new practice of Breslev, which is still, I would say, one of the defining practices of what it means to be a Breslev Hasid, which is different than any other group. And that is the practice that Breslev was called Hitbodedut. Hitbodedut means being alone with God. To be a Breslov Chassid, in addition to davening three times a day as a good Orthodox Jew, in addition to davening three times a day, you have to spend an hour a day alone with God, talking, bringing out your pain, bringing out your sorrow. The rules are as follows. You must do it alone. No other person may hear you, preferably out of doors if you can. If not, in a room, in a closed room by yourself. During that hour, you are to speak to God out loud in your native language. If it's Yiddish, Yiddish. If it's English, English, whatever it is. No liturgy, nothing from the prayer book, no stock formulas. Talk to God for an hour. And the purpose of that hour, he says, is to break your heart. In the course of that hour, you have to try to achieve a broken heart before God. The rest of the day, he says, be happy. Do anything you can. Even tell jokes. Be as joyous as you can. But then for an hour a day, go and break your heart before God. That's what it means to be a Breslov Chassid. And indeed, the rest of us still do it. I had the privilege of studying with one of the elders of the Breslov community in Jerusalem back in the 1960s or 70s with Vidal Yekenexal. And I said to him, do you still all practice this? Is this still an essential part of Breslov practice? An hour, he bundled it, so he smiled at me and said, sometimes we only do a 3/4 of an hour. So I said, you see, we're all conservative Jews. But the real question is not, can you do his brain this for 45 minutes, but can you do it for 50 minutes? It's the 50-minute hour, you understand. Because the insight of Nachman of Breslov and the insight of another Jewish spiritual healer, a century later, not terribly far away in Vienna, was the same insight, I think. If you verbalize it, you'll make it better. Say it out loud. Saying it out loud will change something, will reduce the pain. Nachman as a Rebbe is a healer. The tzaddik in Breslov, unlike in any other, more than any other group, and unlike many, is devoted to healing the personal pain of the disciple. And the people attracted to Breslov from the beginning, but also later in Poland, when there was a revival of Breslov in Warsaw in the early 20th century. And since the 1980s and 1990s, when Breslov has so revived itself in Jerusalem, the people attracted to Breslov are people with a burden of pain, who need the release, who need the gift of Yitbodhut in order to be able to say it out loud, who need a Rebbe who understands them, because he too has been through terrible personal pain and struggle. That's what's unique about Breslov. The model of the Rebbe is the model of the wounded healer. The Rebbe is a tzaddik, not because he has a high neshama, comes from a better place than you, not even because of his descent, and we'll get to his family story in a moment, but because anything you go through, any pain you have, any questioning you have, any suffering, any doubt you have, the Master has been through all of that and worse and has overcome it. Therefore, he can understand you, and therefore he can guide you. You become a tzaddik not because of high lineage or a high soul. You become a tzaddik by hard work, by suffering, by struggle. And that was Nachman's story. Now the story. Nachman, as many of you hear this probably know, was the great-grandson of the Baal Shem Tov, the founder of the Hasidic movement, or the first key figure, the figure around whom the Hasidic movement crystallized. The Baal Shem Tov died in 1760, Nachman was born in 1772, so he never met this great-grandfather, but he was brought up on the family story, and on his legend, and on his great wisdom. Nachman's uncle, Baruch of Mezhbush, was the first figure in the history of Hasidism to claim that he was a spiritual master because of lineage. He began the, I believe, ultimately destructive feature of Hasidism, of dynastic leadership. You are a Rebbe because you descended from Rebbes. Baruch, already by the 1780s, was establishing a large court, a way of lavish living. He was becoming a kind of, you might say, Hasidic prince or a Hasidic nobleman. Nachman saw this and couldn't stand it. He believed his uncle was a phony. And he was deeply disappointed in what had happened to Hasidism. You may call Breslov one of the earliest attempts at internal reform in the Hasidic movement, because he already, by the 1780s, 1790s, saw the seeds of decline as they existed around the court of his uncle and other similar figures. But Nachman was a struggler. He was a struggler from childhood on. We, of course, have a window into his childhood only from things he told his disciples later on. But I want to read you two passages about Nachman's youth, which he told to his disciples, and we'll tell you something about how it was understood and what the memory of his early suffering was like. Let me read you first something very typical of adolescents, adolescent boys. Here we go. The great power of the holy level he achieved in breaking down the most basic of all desires, sexual lust, which includes all other base passions within it, cannot possibly be fully told. He said he had undergone countless trials, great and awesome trials with regard to this desire, which cannot be discussed in detail. When he was still very young, at the time when a person's blood boils, he suffered countless trials in this regard. It was within his power to satisfy his lusts, and he was thus in very grave danger. Being a powerful warrior, however, he succeeded in overcoming his passions. This happened to him a great many times. Nevertheless, he would not seek to avoid being tested further in this matter. On the contrary, he longed to be tested, and would pray to God that he try him once again. He did this out of a confidence that he would not rebel against God. How could he possibly sin and transgress against God's will unless, God forbid, he were to go mad right then and there? The maddening passion of adolescent sexual desire. And now, Nachman's youth altogether, but Nachman's youth, I'd say, the second passage again of what he told Rav Nosson later on about his youth, the second passage is built on the first one. No act in the service of God came easily to him. Everything came only as a result of great and oft-repeated struggle. He rose and fell thousands and thousands of times, really beyond all counting. It was terribly difficult for him even to enter into the service of God, to accept the yoke of his service. He would enter into worship for a certain number of days, and then would experience a fall. He would go back, start over, and then fall again. Finally, after many such cycles, he would gain strength and decide he would remain committed to God's service forever, allowing nothing in the world to lead him astray. From that time forth, his heart was strongly with God, but even afterward, he would constantly undergo countless rises and falls. It was his way to start anew each time. When he fell from his rung, he would not allow himself to despair, but would rather set himself to begin again, as though he had never yet entered the service of God. At times he had several such starts within one day. Even in a single day, he could fall several times and have to begin all over again. Well, that's a model of what it means to be a religious person who's constantly involved in struggle. Indeed, this struggle must have seemed sometimes maddening. And so we have the famous story. How can I talk about Nachman of Breslov and not tell you this story, even though many will have heard it before? In the later Breslov literature attributed to Nachman, but we're pretty sure it's authentic to him, he tells the story of the king's son who thought he was a turkey. I'm recording the story the week before Thanksgiving, so my indic is already safely in the refrigerator. I can therefore tell the story with equanimity. The king's son thought he was a turkey. The king had a great banquet for all his noblemen every day, and in the midst of the banquet, as they were sitting around the table, the king's son would walk in stark naked and go crawling under the table and saying, "Gobble, gobble, gobble, I'm a turkey." It was terribly embarrassing to the king's son. Wasn't a small child anymore. And so the king issued a decree saying, anybody in my kingdom who can heal my son may have great reward. And all kinds of doctors came and tried to heal the son, and they could do nothing. Until one wise man came along and said, "Give me a chance, your majesty. I think I know how to heal your son." So the next day, the banquet begins, In walks the, in howls the son, again naked, again under the table saying, gabba, gabba, gabba. And after there for a few minutes, the wise man walks in, also naked as the day he was born, gets under the table and says, gabba, 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 I'm a turkey too. And they begin talking, Shalom Aleichem, where does the turkey come from? And what does the turkey do? And the son, king's son was very happy to have found a friend. He had a fellow turkey under the table and was gobbling all around. The next day, the king's son is under the table waiting for his new friend to come, and the wise man comes in hopping like a turkey, but wearing a pair of pants. And the king's son looks at the wise man and says, what are you doing? Turkeys don't wear pants. And the wise man says, where I come from, if turkeys want to wear pants, they can. And the next day, the king's son had a pair of pants too. And the day after that, it was a shirt. And a week later, it was a pair of shoes. Until finally, the wise man had the king's son sitting at the table, eating with a knife and fork, fully dressed, just like everybody else. And nobody anymore knew he was a turkey. You understand? The master, the tzaddik, as wounded healer. He is the wounded healer because only a person who had once been a turkey could know how to do that. You understand? Only a person who understood from within what turkeyhood means could be that kind of healer. That's the healer Nachman is. If you look at the literature of Bratislav, it's filled with discussion of longing for God, the outcry for God, the feeling of being abandoned. Terms like gagulim, longings, and yiniot, obstacles, things that keep you from God, are mainstays of Bratislav literature. You don't find them anywhere else in Hasidism. Those terms are not key terms in most of Hasidic literature. They belong to Bratislav because Bratislav is about a Hasidism for people who feel obstacles in the way and therefore break down in longing and crying for God. Nachman himself is that kind of figure. At first he refused to have disciples. As I say, he saw his uncle's Hasidism, he saw what it meant to be a Rebbe, even though he was the Baal Shem Tov's great-grandson, it was expected that he would somehow be in the lineage, he wanted nothing to do with it. But then in 1798 he took a transformative journey to Eretz Yisrael, and there when he came back, he began to allow himself, his spiritual life having been renewed somehow by that pilgrimage, he allowed himself to have a small group of disciples. Always very small, always elite. His closest disciple of Nussan, Nathan of Nemirov, writes in his own memoir that before he came to Nachman, he went around to different rabbis, he tried different people. Probably he went to Berditchev, he went to different places, saw styles of different rabbis. He came to Nachman because only Nachman really spoke to his soul. And Nachman only wanted people who had souls that were alike to his. People that struggled for faith. He began teaching. Nachman's collected teachings, published in a book called Likutei Maran, probably published in his lifetime, is quite an amazing document. He has a brilliant associative mind. He had no teachers, by the way. We have no idea who taught Nachman. He is mostly an autodidact. But he knows an incredible amount. Beyond knowledge that was typical for his day, I would say he knew obscure parts of the Bible very well. He is constantly quoting verses from Proverbs and Job, things that texts that most people did not know well, from the prophets. He knew rabbinic literature, especially Agadah, very well. Talmud, Midrashim, obscure parts of the Zohar, Tikkuni Zohar, was a very important religious text for him. And most of this came on his own. He also has a brilliant kind of associative mind. His teachings are all about, you might say, almost free association, links between things. There's always a play on words, a pun, a gematria, something numerological, whatever it is that links one idea to the next, but he jumps from one thing to the next. You don't know how they're going to be connected, and then somehow he ties them all together in a somehow astonishing way. Nachman is, as a Hasidic teacher, creative and lyrical. There is a poetic side of him. I remember he talks about how Yes, there's a verse in Genesis that says that Yuval and Tuval Kain are brothers. One is the father of shepherds and one is the father of musicians. He says, why are they brothers? Because music comes from the earth, from the corners of the earth. From the corners of the earth we hear singing. And shepherds take their flocks around to different places, and every place the flocks go, there's another melody. And the shepherds know the melodies which will sustain their flocks. The melodies go with the grasses. And you have a kind of beautiful pastoral image of shepherding and music. And there's something about Nachman that is a kind of literary, lyrical figure, even in this volume of teachings. He also is a person who understands the distance from God, the feeling of the absence of God in human life. People feel that God is far from them. People feel abandoned by God. Nachman also felt abandoned by God. And the people who become his disciples are people who share some of that feeling. They too have had a sense that God is far from them and they need to cry out. I like to say that Nachman plays almost a devil's advocate toward his great-grandfather, the Baal Shem Tov. The Baal Shem Tov came along and said, open your eyes, God is everywhere. In every place, in every moment, you can see God. Now, the Baal Shem Tov going out to the woods and finding God in the trees and fields and grasses. Nachman says, Zevi, I tried, but it's not true. I didn't find it. I found God distant from me. I looked, and God wasn't there. What should I do? I like to say that Nachman to the Baal Shem Tov plays the role that the author of Job plays to the book of Deuteronomy, the book of Dvarim. The author of Dvarim says, if you truly love me, listen to me, I'll give you your wine and your corn and your oil and fat flocks and good things and rich fields. The author of Job says, it's not true, that's right, it's not true, it's a lie. But yet Nachman understood that there's a difference between what he called emet and emet la'amito. On some level, it's true that God is absent. On some level, it's true that you are alone in the world, and your pain in God's absence is very real. But then you have to go down to a deeper level of truth. You have to go from emet to emet la'amito. And in emet la'amito, indeed, the Baal Shem Tov is right, God is everywhere. And if you learn really to open your eyes and transcend and walk across that narrow bridge across your doubts, you'll find the presence of God on the other side. But that requires a journey of faith and a struggle for faith and a struggle for joy that the Baal Shem Tov didn't have to understand, because for the Baal Shem Tov, joy was natural. For Nachman, it was a real struggle. Nachman faces depression, faces loneliness, faces emptiness, and overcomes it. That's the secret of his strength as a spiritual master. He didn't live long. He starts to become a rebbe around 1801, 1802, just after the turn of the 19th century. By 1806, he's already ill with tuberculosis, the disease that would take his life in 1810. In his last few years, he's going through a terrible struggle with the illness. Also a great conflict, should he go visit doctors? Should he believe only in God's healing power? Or should he allow himself the tiny advances of modern medicine that were there at his time? He goes to a doctor in Lemberg, and the doctor doesn't cure him. And then Nachman curses doctors and says, you know, the angel of death is very busy. He can't go all the places he has to go every day. So he has these assistants called doctors, whom he sends there to do his dirty work for him. He didn't like doctors. He theoretically believed in healing by faith alone, by trust in God alone. But in those last few years, something else happened in Nachman's life. Two other things happened in Nachman's life that were key. One is he thought he could bring the Messiah. He believed the end was near. There was a tradition of the Baal Shem Tov's family that they were descended from the house of David, and the Messianic soul would be born in that family. And so we thought that maybe his son, who was born in 1806, would turn out to be the Messiah. The child tragically died after a year and a half, and Nachman was very hurt and very disappointed. He then said the reason redemption hasn't come, the reason the Messiah hasn't come, is because we're not ready. Why are we not ready? because we can't imagine it, we can't dream it. Our imaginations are too overcome by lust, by desire, by sin, by this world. And what I have to do in order to prepare the minds of a generation for the coming of the redemption is to change your imaginations. And in order to do that, I have to give you a fantasy life that's more powerful and more attractive than your own fantasies. And so Nachman in 1806 begins to tell stories. Now stories exist all over Hasidism. The Baal Shem Tov was a storyteller. But Nachman's stories are of an entirely different order. His stories are mostly not about Jews, they're not about Regis. They don't have an obvious meaning, an obvious moral point, as most Hasidic stories do. They're stories about fantasy realms, kings and princes and princesses, children who are lost in exchange, wandering beggars, pirates who capture ships on the sea, strange stories. Some of them may come from East European folktale motifs that he heard perhaps from non-Jews in the towns where he was raised. But they're powerful stories. They're stories that evoke something of what you have to call the primitive mythical imagination. Nachman talks about most stories, he says, come from within the normal span of a human lifetime. They're tales b'toch 70 shana, within the 70 years of a human life. But these stories, he says, come from ancient times, come from before that 70 years of our lives. He is like Franz Kafka in that way, maybe like Borges, like a few people who tap into the mythic imagination. Nachman's tales, recorded in both Hebrew and Yiddish, have become classics of early modern Jewish literature. And it's partly because of that wonderful imagination that's witnessed in the tales that Nachman is so well known. Now, he's a spiritual seeker. He's a teller of tales. He's a mystic, no question about it. In his tales, he talks about going back to the primal nothing, remembering existence before existence was, when there was nothing at all. He talks about the ancient truth that somehow one can discover. And he left his disciples a rich legacy of loyalty to him, of love for him. He said, the world will forever, till the end of time, learn from the love that exists in our little community. In that sense, the group in Breslau is like the group in Mezrich a generation before, like the group around the Baal Shem Tov, like the group around the Yoshihai and Yitzhato 100 years earlier, almost in Padua, Italy, like the fantasy group around Rabbi Shimon ben Yochai, who created the Zohar. In some ways, Jewish mysticism has always been studied in these small, intimate groups of master and disciple. The group in Breslau certainly belongs on that list of powerful spiritual masters and disciples who passed on and created in the tradition. After Nachman died, Nussin became leader of the Breslau community but refused to be Rebbe, saw himself only as his faithful disciple. Later Breslau history went on for 150 years in Europe. Nussin lived until 1845, when others took over. As I said, they were a small persecuted group. They were probably no more than a few hundred families by the end of the 19th century. Then there was a small revival of Breslau in Warsaw. By the turn of the 20th century, there was a Breslau community in Jerusalem. The original Breslau was almost completely destroyed, first by Sovietization in the 1920s, and then, of course, by the Germans, by the Nazis, Yimashman, who wiped out everything left in the Ukraine of traditional Jewish life. Nachman's famous chair, which his disciples had made for him, was smuggled out piece by piece in the 1930s and reassembled in Jerusalem. When I first began studying Breslau, there were three Breslau synagogues, maybe four Breslau synagogues in the whole world, three in Jerusalem and one in Brooklyn, or maybe two in Brooklyn. That was it. There were certainly no more than a very few thousand Breslau Hasidim. But in the 1980s and 1990s, Breslau decided to follow the path of Lubavitch, of Chabad, and modernize and expand and reach out and translate and try to attract seekers and try to attract young people. And it has transformed itself into one of the leading Hasidic groups, and certainly one of the leading Hasidic groups to which people from the outside of access. Breslov has always welcomed seekers, has always had new people coming in, people who were attracted to the message of Reb Nachman, but now more than ever. And differing groups of recovering alcoholics and drug addicts from the streets of Jerusalem have become Breslov Hasidim. Wide-eyed, post-hippie and post-drug infatuation, Westerners and Americans have become members of the Nachman group of extreme Breslov Hasidim. The elderly Hasidim in Jerusalem look askance at some of these new phenomena, but nevertheless they're all part of a greater Breslov community and they have to learn to live with one another because they're all disciples of the same very remarkable Rebbe, probably the most remarkable spiritual healer in the history of Judaism, who remains to this day the living Rebbe of the Historia Hasidim. Thank you. God bless.